You got to be by the microphone so it can be recorded, though, Mark. Yeah, put that one on.
Good morning, everybody. First, I'd like to turn to some scripture, Proverbs 14:12. And 14:12 reads, "This is a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death." So what I related to this is everything I was doing seemed right in my mind, never thinking about the end and not caring about the end, living just for today. And then if you turn to 2 Corinthians 5:15, and it reads, "And that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves," which is definitely what I was doing, "but unto him which died for them and rose again."
Amen. 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 That's good. Amen.
And there's only one more verse. I won't burden you with too many verses here. 2 Corinthians 5:17. And it says, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new." And if that ain't the most truest thing in the world, then I ain't standing here in front of you. I'm an illusion. Okay, because I was involved pretty heavily in organized crime, which at the time was one of the most powerful of the New York Five families. And I was involved in loan sharking, bookmaking, union corruption, payoffs, enforcing. I mean, I can go on and on. If there was money involved, I was involved in it. And Shylocking was one of my bigger parts of my business that I was doing. And I was living a really violent life, and it showed in my house. In front of my wife and kids, I would break things up and couldn't even talk to me. I'd be the nastiest person you ever seen. And that's because it's the company you keep. And I stood with some of the most ruthless people that the movies will have trouble portraying how bad they were. And one day in 1998, in the fall of 98, there was a customer that had borrowed money from me time to time. And for 2 weeks in a row, he couldn't pay me my VIG interest, in other words. Couldn't pay the full amount of interest, and for 2 weeks in a row I'd slap him around or give him a beating, however you want to put it. And the third week when I went to go collect off of him, it was the same story, except this time here's a grown man older than me crying that he wants to kill himself. So I told him, "Well, if you want to kill yourself, pay me the money you owe me, and then I'll even give you the gun that you could do it with. But give me what you owe me first." And he said he needed to talk to a pastor or a priest. And I looked at him like, "You're talking to the devil. I don't know nothing about those kind of people." And the person I was with at the time was my driver. And he said, "Mark, have a heart for this guy. The guy's sick. You can't see this guy sick?" I'm like, I don't want to know it. So he said, There's a men's meeting at this church that I go to once in a while. Nobody knows I've been going. And this person that I'm talking about, my driver, was the worst of the worst. Made me look like an altar boy. And here he is showing mercy to this guy. So I said, well, I don't want no part of that. If you want to take him wherever you want to take him, you can take him tonight. I don't want no part of it. 7 o'clock, my friend showed up at my door. He said, come on, just take a ride, he said. This guy, this pastor in this church is an old friend of ours from Brooklyn. Used to be a knock-around guy. So I said, all right, I'll take a ride, but I ain't getting out of the car. We went to this here church on Richmond Avenue. And he said, Mark, just come in. I just want you to meet the guy, then you could leave. So I went in against my will, no doubt. And there was about 10 men there, and they joined hands to pray. And one of the guys went to grab my hand. And I used every vulgar word that you could imagine. And I gave him a look that if looks could kill, he would have been dead. And I walked out. And I didn't get too far from the front door of that church. And, you know, when people say God spoke to me, well, God spoke to me loud and clear to my heart. I wasn't looking for God. I had no interest in God. I knew I was going to hell and I didn't care. You know, we used to joke, we'll be in hell together. We'll be drinking beer and eating steak. Like it was a joke. But I resisted again and I tried to walk a little further to the car and I couldn't walk. It was like God was speaking to my heart, telling me, you know what? What you really need is right here. And I went back in, something my wife could attest to. Nobody had more pride than me. I would never show weakness or swallow my pride for nobody. And I went back in, and I went over to the pastor, and I said, would you pray with me? And it was like, I can't believe that I'm doing, it's not me doing this. And they prayed with me, and I cried. Something, another thing I never do in front of another man, ever. And I felt like the whole church was lifted off of me, like a building was on top of me. And I didn't get salvation because of that church, neither, because they didn't give me the gospel of salvation. But I remembered my mother telling me since I was a little kid, the only way to get to heaven is through Jesus Christ. Amen. So no matter how they were praying, I was praying to Jesus to come into my heart and be my Savior. Amen. And when we finished praying, the pastor said to me, you know, you and your friend Mike here, you think you brought this guy here for help, but actually, Jesus used him to bring you here. Amen. And I've continued going to church ever since. And I used to tell the pastor this story, you know what I'm saying now, what happened. And I would refer to the guy as the victim, because I would never want to mention names. And a few years after I was coming to this church, this was a different church that I was going to at the time until I came here the first time. And then God just led me to believe this is the church I should be in. The first Bible I grabbed in a Christian bookstore in Jersey was a King James Bible. And that church used an NIV. And I don't think that was a coincidence neither. That was God's hand leading me. So, as I explained to the pastor my testimony the first time, and I told him this victim, this and that, and a few months later, this guy would call me up, and my wife would tell him, I'm not at home, I'm at church. So he'd leave a message for me to call him back. He'd say, wow, you're still going to church? I can't believe it. I said, yeah. I said, but I'm not going to that church where we went that night. I said, going to this little church on Amboy Road, you wouldn't know the church. And he said, not First Bible Church, would it be? It was like I got hit with a baseball bat. I was like, yeah. He said, well, remember I told you I got saved in jail? The pastor, Mike Veach, brought me to Christ in prison. So then I spoke to Pastor Mike. I said, that victim I always spoke about? You led him to Christ in prison, and he knew right away who I was talking about. And as many times as I beat that guy up, he became one of my best friends. And only God could do that, because if anybody did to me what I did to that guy, I could never look at them. Thank you.
Will be forever.